Hi, this is MC Zetti for a new episode of my modding tutorials for 1.15. And there were a few problems in last episode. So this one is actually, someone told this to me. These cuts are a bit too dark. And the reason for that is this line. It's for the light map. Apparently I should use this. So let's recompile. By the way, if you run IntelliJ in debug mode, for those simple changes like this, it will reload the client automatically, so I don't have to restart. So if I place it now, yeah, this one is also recalculated. So you see it's much brighter. And this is probably more correct. It will probably also be much brighter if you much darker. Yeah, so it's still correct. Yeah, that looks to be okay. So that's one thing that I fixed, or that someone else fixed for me at least. And I also forget. So let's commit this. Fix for the baked model light map calculation. Note that this is not relevant while mimicking, because then we get vertices from our block that we are mimicking. Another thing that I forgot to mention is in cases where the mimic is mimicking grass, do I have a situation here, or I can quickly make one. This grass, this mimic actually has the right color for the biome. If I were to put the same mimic here, you see how it's also colored according to biome, so it uses the right mimicking colors. And that happens in this one. So you need to make a class that implements yblock color. It's an interface that has just one method, getColor, which gets a block state, which gets a light reader, which is actually an extension of block reader. And if you go check at implementations, the client world and the server world both implement that. So actually, if you have a world, that's actually, you can give that as light color. The position and the input colors. So how is this used then? This get color we implemented, first we get, so this light reader is world, we get a tile entity. If it's our own fancy block tile, we get the mimic, and if that is defined, we get the mimic from that block. The color from that block, I mean. So that means that we will use the logic for grass in case we have a block of grass here. And this is the tint, actually. So we delegate the getting of the colors to the actual block that we are mimicking. If we wouldn't do this, say we just use... how can I quickly test this? Yeah, if we just use the default, so that means world would get block state plus and return block state one would get it's like this. Yeah, but that will cause. What does the default return actually? This block colors. I'm just checking quickly what it returns to show you how it would look. No, that's not. Let's just return minus 1 and see what that gives. Where is the grass mimic? Yeah, here. Yeah, that's how it would look like. No colors. So the color is completely disabled then. So this is the fix. It's not a fix, I had already implemented that, I just forgot to show it to you. And how to actually register it? That's in client setup, and that's with this line. So you get the block colors from the Minecraft instance, register or implementation of Y block colors, and the block for which we want to use it. So that's how this works. In this tutorial, I want to actually explain our last block, which is this one. There are a few things I want to talk about here. First is how this model works. You see, it's a somewhat more complex model with an inner cube and an outer cube and transparent textures. Also, let's put these away. You can toggle the sides. This is actually used by RF Tools Power. There you have a similar thing. So this is a model with more complex states and some interaction. And how is this done? First, again, like everything, complex multi-part block, you have the block. So the usual things are there, a small render shape to make sure that if you have adjacent, that nothing is culled away. So you see it works correctly this way. If this wasn't there and get render shape, this one, as soon as I put this one here, it would not render this side of the grass block because it would think this occupied the entire space. So that's for that. That's just the constructor, the information, the tile entity. The tile entity in this case is needed to remember these. You could put that actually. Actually, do I need that for that? Technically, I don't really need it. You could do it with the block alone, because the states are actually recorded as properties of the block states. You see, we have, for every state, we have a mode enum, which is implemented here, which has three values, none, input and output. And so every side, north, south, east, west, and so on, has this three values as a property. But in this case, we also store it with the tile entity, and the tile entity will update the state. That can be, in some cases, more easily, for example, if you also want to put logic in it, then the tile entity has that information as well. It doesn't have to get it from the block state. But that's actually, in this particular case, this is redundant. We could actually just get rid of this and get rid of the entire tile entity. It's just there. So then on block activated, we want to toggle the mode. So what does this do? This checks that we are the right tile entity. It goes to toggle mode. Actually, we also do this only on server side. Toggle mode, it will change the modes and it will update the state according to that. So this implementation could be different. It could be put here instead of in the tile entity, and it could read the properties and toggle them through the properties to changing the block state. We don't need any client-server communication here, to communicate these style entities, these modes to the client, because we change the block state. We do a block state update with these flags, which will cause the client also to update. So that's why we don't need, for example, if you remember, here, we needed all this because our render information, the mimic, the block we're mimicking, has to be communicated from the tile entity, from the server to the client. That's not needed here. Okay, let's do that. We actually don't have a baked model or anything. Everything is done with regular JSON. So if you go check the registration for the complex multipart, we just have these three, where the last one is optional. And if you go look at the block state, it's this. So it's a multipart. That means that this model is actually made out of multiple submodels. This is a vanilla thing. And so if you look at this, you have the multipart. We say we always apply the main block. That's this one. Yeah, it's actually, it corresponds. Let me check it out. Yeah, it corresponds to this outline and the inner class, because if you see, it only uses the window texture. The window texture, which is defined, where is it defined? Yeah, here, complex window. And that actually includes the border at the transparent part. So that's why we can use the same texture for this entire thing. And then we have when down is equal to none, we apply a single none with no rotation. When up is equal to none, we apply single none with x axis rotated 180 degrees, and so on. And then you have the same with the input mode. So these are conditional parts. They only apply when a certain property is set. And the three models that we're using is just one face. It's used for the inner face, which is only for one side. And there are three possibilities. You have single in input, single none, no input or no output, and single out. And those three are these three. And by combining them and rotating them, we built up the six sides of our inner cube. Of course, to make this JSON with all the correct rotations, that's a bit of work. So we also generate that in our data gen packet. And that's a bit more complicated. So let's register this. That's this method. So first, we make a block model builder for our main model. So the main model that was the outer frame and the windows, not the inner block, but the outer frame and the windows. So I have made a floating cube method, which simply on our block model builder makes one element. So an element corresponds to, here you see one element. It says from this coordinate to these coordinates, one single face, the face down with this texture. And that's also what happens here. From this coordinate to this coordinate, all faces, in this case it's for a cube, because, well, a cube rectangular, so it's this shape or this shape, so you have several of these. And also the glass is also a cube, but with slightly smaller dimensions, so that it's embedded a bit. And we set, for all faces, we set the same texture, which is window. So that's, every floating cube will add a cube with these coordinates. So this one, all these, 12 of them, are for 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. So this, the, they are for the 12 frame parts. That's these. And then for the transparent part, you have the inner cube. Starts from 1, 1, 1 to 15, 15, 15. And these together, we define the texture for it, which is complex window. That's the texture I showed you earlier. These correspond to this model, create dimensional cell model. So what does, what happens now? This model, which contains the outer frame, will be used as a parameter for our block. But some things will be added to it, that's here. So we have that frame. And then we create three models for these three models. So these represent a single quad, on the downside actually, representing one single face in each of the three modes. So non, input, output, with this texture, this name, with the single texture and the single complex out. So you find these textures. So that's this one, and this one. Only the inner part is used of this texture. This is actually not used. That doesn't really matter. Okay. So these are the three models that we use. We get a new multi-part block state builder, not a new one, but a multi-part block state builder. So here we made a block model builder, and here we have a multi-part block state builder, which depends on block states. So the first part we add is our main model, our frame. So that's this one, that represents that one. And then we have three models depending on, so if you go look at this enum, this is at index 0, index 1, index 2, index 0, index 1, index 2. So that's how we get for each value of the mode the corresponding model to use. That's one of these three models. And there we have the to apply the correct rotation to get that downside facing the correct way. And these are added, all added as a part to our multi-part block state builder. And that's actually everything there is to it. So you just call that, you just add at the parts, you don't even have to do anything with it later, it just works, it will generate that JSON. So this is a more complicated generator, but it's pretty useful, and it allows you to make more complex models like these. In older versions of my mods, RF2's Power, I made this model in Blender, which is also possible. Then you get an OBG object that you can also read from within Minecraft. But this is more flexible. And it's also more standard, standard vanilla. This model would actually work without in a non-modded, in a vanilla environment. So this concludes this tutorial. I hope you liked it, and I hope you can use it for your own mods. So see you next time. Bye bye.